I think maybe we can start. I will still let anyone, any person that come a little bit late, that's gonna be no problem. So hope everybody can hear me well, no problem. So well, yes, on behalf of IWAS Wheelchair Fencing, I want to welcome you everybody. Good day, good evening, good night, depending on the part of the world that you are right now. This is our third seminar that we are producing from behalf of IWAS, and definitely it's not going to be the last one. We hope that every time we are improving. And I think this is going to be a very nice one. I just wanted to share before we start that, well, we put together this seminar and we put a limit to the number of participants, and it was full so fast in just like 3 days that we decided to do a second one. So the weekend after, we will have again this seminar. And that really makes us very happy. The number of entries that we have right now for both of the seminars, so this weekend and next weekend, is around 172 participants. And from 50 countries all over the world. Let's hope that the real assistance will be close to that number, but still for us is amazing that there is this much interest in our activities. This is a very nice seminar, the subject that we are going to talk. Peter is going to present it later, but I just want to say that Peter from the Austrian Wheelchair Fencing Federation, Mirani, and all Dimitris and his team, they have really been working very hard to put together this. And I hope that everybody can, will enjoy it and motivate everybody to start working in wheelchair fencing. A lot of people here, I know that they already work in wheelchair fencing, but we still have a lot of new countries and new persons. So that's great. Before we start, before I give the word to Peter, first I want to introduce myself for the ones who doesn't know me. My name is Alberto Cruz, but here in the Zoom meeting I appear, I think I was Zoom. I am part of the semi-commission of IWAS Wheelchair Fencing, and I'm also the development officer. So I'm working with the IWAS office in coordinating all these efforts to bring seminars and different activities in with the idea of developing our sport in all around the world. Very quickly, Dimitris will show you later and I will put it in the chat. We will have a way of doing the questions through slido.com. There you're going to have the code to enter. There you can put the question, you can vote for the you can go to slido.com with your cell phone or your computer. You can put the code that is there and you can put the question there. You can vote for the questions if there are some that is interesting for you, because we are going to try to answer all of them. But the idea is that the most interesting one for the person, we go first with those. I will put this information also in the chat. The chat is open there. We will try to do all the questions through Slido, but still, if you wish to put something in the chat, we'll be checking it. As usually with these things, I will ask you to have your microphone muted. Still, we are going to try to answer all the questions in the end. And in the end, if somebody wants to talk or say something, just that you can raise a hand, we can give you the word. That's no problem. But for now, let's try to keep the microphones in mute. And I think that's for now. Again, I will give the word to Peter and Dimitris and his team. I'll be in the chat. If you need something, some help or something, just write. We have no problem. So let me introduce you first, Peter. Peter Brigola. He is the president of the Austrian Wheelchair Fencing Federation, and also he's a member of the executive committee of IWAS. He is the representative for Europe. And him and Mirani from Austria Wheelchair Fencing, they have worked very hard in putting together this seminar. And he will give a welcome also, and he will explain a little bit our goals for this seminar. So, Peter, all yours.
Okay, thank you. I hope you can hear me. Good evening, everybody, everyone. I would like to express my happiness and warmly welcome you on behalf of IWAS and of course, on behalf of everybody involved. The unbelievable result of the seminar marked by this large number of participants shows us that we are really on the right track. And as you know, a coach with his extensive technical, mental, and psychological abilities, paired with his incredible patience, empathy, and leadership, quality is closely linked to his success of the athlete and his club. She or he also is mom, dad, best friends, troubleshooter, or sometimes also comforter for the soul. This seminar aims to give you an overview of the possibilities of a coach who can be achieved in the wheelchair fencing. Our goal is to show a little bit of our daily life in wheelchair fencing, to show how great it can be to work together with Paralympic sport, and above all, to open the doors for all those interested to be part of our family. First, I would like to express and I would like to explain the persons. First, I'd like to say thank you for the good and creative soul who tirelessly, very professionally, brought this project to life and brought the right persons together, who not only manages wheelchair fencing in Austria, which with patience and assistance, but also her husband. Thank you, best wife of all. Thank you, Mirani and Fernandez. My special thanks are also going to Alberto Cruz, the IWAS development officer, as you recognized, for his support in realizing this series of seminars and for his hard working in developing wheelchair fencing. I'd like to say deeply thank you also to Dimitris Kazaglis for his excellent presentation and his willingness to share his huge experience with us. The Greek team competes Manos Bogdos with his explanations about classification, and Iason Athanasiadis, tomorrow he will be introduced to him, about his experience as a referee. Thank you for all making this project happen. But now I think it's time enough to talk. Dimitris, please start.
Good evening. I will share the presentation now, so we can start. Good evening to all. It's unbelievable today. Hello, hola. My name is Dimitris Kazaglis. I am the national wheelchair fencing coach of Greece. I want to thank IWAS Fencing Committee and Peter Brigola and Austrian Wheelchair Fencing Federation for the great honor and trust they gave me to be a presenter of our sport. I also want to thank Manos Bogdos, the IWAS medical classifier, and also my athlete. Iason Athanasiadis, IWAS referee, and also my athlete. And also my fencers, Kelly Loufaki and Vasilis Dounis, who will help this presentation. Also, I want to thank Christina Masiala, the equal representation and member of IWAS Fencing, for helping me with this project. And of course, Mirani Fernandez and Udo Ziegler for their help. I will try to introduce you and guide you to basics of wheelchair fencing, and transmit to you my experience and my love and my knowledge to you. I want also to thank all Paralympic fencers and coaches. I will explain you now, we have 3 days of the seminar. The first day We have, as you see, the introductions, history of sport basics, basic information, description of the sport, the impairments, classification rules, experience of a woman fencer, Kelly Lufaki, and questions and answers in the end. I will explain you later the program. I will show you later all the program, the day two or day three. We have all the time to do it. Now, we will start with a gift from Japan, from Yuka Fujita, who is a friend with a positive energy, who follows every competition in every wheelchair fencing, and send us this special video for this special day for all of you. Enjoy. Okay. So this was a great, great gift from Japan. I want to make an applause for her. Bravo, bravo, Yuka, because this difficult time we needed this video. When I saw in the first time this video, I was a little emotional, and because I miss you all, I miss all the coaches in wheelchair fencing and all the athletes. This difficult period, we are all together here because we have a common passion. Okay, this common passion is fencing. What you definitely suspect is that wheelchair fencing will give you more than just the beautiful experience you've had so far in fencing. Well, it is true. The wheelchair fencing family will give you what you are looking for. Strong emotions, new friends, athletes with tremendous mental strength, new techniques, another dimension to travel and feel very happy. I have been in fencing since 1981 as an athlete, Greek champion and member of the Greek national foil team. I studied physical education and sports science and fencing coaching to do my passion as a profession. In 1995, I started working as a coach in clubs and in the national team. An incident influenced my decision and my willingness to engage in wheelchair fencing. A fencer friend from Hungary of the same fencing generation as me, he was an Olympic medalist, then injured in a serious car accident. After years, I learned that this exceptional athlete, an Olympian winner, was a great wheelchair fencing. He was Paul Sekeres. Now he's the president of IWAS Wheelchair Fencing Federation. What a story, what a great story. A person which didn't give up. And today he promotes his sport to help all the society. After that, I started to collect information about the sport and its rules. I had a vision to do it as a new coach. In 2003, however, I had the opportunity to find what I've been looking for. In January 2003, a person with disability just came to my club and asked me to learn fencing. You can see now in the screen, Nikos Pepas, with a congenital disability, never seated in a wheelchair. We started with just a simple chair. You see the chair. We didn't have frames, no frames. And we just had one, no electric foil. Then we started. Finally, in July 2003, with the help of the Greek Federation, we participated in the European Wheelchair Fencing Championship in Paris. And then we had a strange event. We had a problem. The airline company lost our competition wheelchair. But we were fortunate that a Polish fencer offered her wheelchair in this competition. And we finally competed in the wheelchair of a female Paralympic gold medalist in Sydney. The girl was Jakoda Polasik. And we finally competed in this competition. Oh, what happened? I put accidentally music. Chihuahua. You know, this Chihuahua music has a story, you know, and I have to tell you. We have to break the glass. And so this music was
the country from played. My...
was played inside the European Championship in the breaks of between the semifinals and the knockouts. I was outside and I was see the semifinal between Italy and France, a great duel, a great battle between an amazing fencers. I remember Pellegrini, the great Olympic champion, gold medalist in Athens, and also Cyril Moret, one of the legends of the sport. And the coach was one of my friends. I see him with a pleasure today here. He's Fabio Giovannini, he's here. And also And from the other side, the French coach Didier Barras. In the competition, it was very fanatism, shouting, yelling, and suddenly the competition freeze. And the music is played by the organizer of the European Championship. I say, well, what is happening here? And all the coaches and all the fencers started to say Chihuahua. Okay, we had to fence for a medal. These two great countries, the great schools of fencing, and suddenly they stopped the competition and started to sing. So, this was a parenthesis with the spirit of the wheelchair fencing. I wanted to show you. Of course, it wasn't accidentally to put the music. I wanted to show you the spirit and how fun is the wheelchair fencing competition, and how we all enjoy this spirit. I will show you now that when I start fencing, and when we start fencing, we didn't have nothing. We didn't have frames. We didn't have wheelchairs. And we try to do the training in many ways. Without frame, as you see here, with able-bodied fencing fencers and seated fencers in a chair, just a chair, in electric chair here. And also here in my house, we put some frames when we had, and we did a preparation in my house because we didn't have a sal to do. I want to stay here for a moment to make in a memory of this amazing woman who helped us in the first competition, and she's not in life now. She died in 2016. She's Jagoda Polasik, who helped us in this fencing program, and I honor her that she's a member of the Greek team. Thank you very much. Now, we have, after this difficult start with no frames, without wheelchairs, we had a great period of competitions and participations as a Greek team. We started, as I told, the first participation in European Championship, and with one athlete and with no wheelchair fencing equipment. After we had the honor to compete in four Paralympic Games in Athens with Pepas Nikos and Manos Bogdos, who will speak to you later in the classification. In Beijing, we competed again with Manos Bogdos, Gerasimos Pilarinos, George Alexakis. In London with Bogdos, Pilarinos, Alexakis, and Triadafilou. And in Rio 2016, our last Paralympic Games, we competed with four fencers. The important thing is for the history is that we had the first woman in our team that competed in Paralympic Games, very important historically for Greek fencing. We have been organized Greek wheelchair fencing championships since 2011. I want to thank also my assistant coaches, Kostas Iliopoulos and Despina Perdika and Leonidas Koukos, who is also a referee. Now, about my dream team. I had with this difficult situation, I had the honor and I was very lucky to find excellent fencers who promote and loved our sport and create amazing things for, because I will tell you why. Panos Triadafilou won the silver medal in the Rio Paralympic Games, and Vasilis Dounis Also he was fourth and also win the bronze Paralympic the bronze medal in World Championship in Rome in 2017. Manos Bogdos, who will speak to you today, is a winner of the World Cup ranking in saber B in 2009. My saber team won many gold medals in many World Cups and also a medal in Europe in World Championship. And also we won many medals in European championships. This was amazing because I don't belong to a great school of fencing from France or from Italy or from Russia. I just tell an example of the school because there are many, many schools like Hungary. My coaches were Hungarian and I want to thank them for my knowledge. I had Andra Sambo as a coach who was a master of the arms, a son of the great fencing coach Laszlo Sabo, and also I had Erno Kolcsonai, who was a silver medalist from Hungary, a silver medalist in EPE in Moscow, Olympic Games. As I told you before, the first day today, we have these subjects to speak. Now, I will speak you, all you know, that fencing has a long, long history. I will tell you my history. I will tell you about ancient Greece. I will tell you a history, not how they fight Spartans or Athenians that you know from movies, Spartans. I will tell you about how they had training in the arms and in fencing. So. Pyrrhichios dance, an art dance, is their lesson, their method to learn fencing. It was combined with a lyric poetry. In this dance of the Corybantes, Phrygian and Cretan tribes, Pyrrhichios is an amalgamation of religious, military, and mimic dances. The dancers were armed and leaped from side to side with vivid and violent gestures. They were imitating defense and attack movements and all phases of a real fight. At the same time, they slammed their shields and sword to recreate a battle. According to the well-known myth about Zeus, the sound of the Corybantes' shields was used to cover the baby cries of the baby god who was hiding in the Crete from his mean father Cronos, who eated his child, you know. This dance was divided in four parts. Podisme, you remember this word, consisting of rapid movements of the feet, which were necessary to advance of the enemy or to escape. As we say today, the footwork of the ancient Greeks. Xiphisme, or the simulated battle, Plato describes as a very active mimetic exercise made of running steps, skipping steps, retrograde steps, wheelie steps, kneeling, infinitely varied arm movements, combining all the artifice of the wrestling and the dance. The cosmos, where they perform very high jumps, a form of training to overcome obstacles or walls. And finally, we have the tetrachomo, a slow and majestic move performed in a square, accompanied by the sound of the avlos. Avlos is a flute and a lively song performed either by the dancers or the singers. In the early days, it was executed by men. Only later, a female partner was added to its shoulder. The scene depicted on painted vase above is below is a scene of the ancient Pyrrhic dance as performed by the Greeks. You will see now a video of the Greek Pontiac dance, which is the modern interpretation of the Pyrrhichios dance. Okay, just a small taste of this just a moment. So you saw the Pyrrhichios dance as it is today with the Pontiac dance Pyrrhichios. Now. We speak about history, and I will give you a sense of what I have in my mind about history, okay, of fencing. The handle of our swords connect us with the history of the world and the heart of the civilizations. In ancient Greece, these weapons were xiphos, dori, aspis, the shield, and also one kopis. Today, weapon names are, as we all know, foil, epe, and saber. According to the Greek historians, inventors of the plomachia, a scrim, were two tribes, the Peloponnesian Arcades and Mantinees. Fencing is an ancient offensive and defensive art. For the Romantic school, it is a passion combining geometry and art science, which endlessly search for perfection. Fencing is music performed with the sword according to the fencer's inner rhythm tempo. Today, fencing is a unique Olympic and Paralympic sport, technical, fast, theatrical, emotional, powerful, a live form of chess. Fencing, oplomachia in Greek, is still being taught in the same traditional manner, from the ancient times by the master to the novice fencer. Only a few fencers become masters, who continue the long tradition by creating their own style. A fencer is a work, as you see left, a fencer is a work of art, sculpted with a great passion and inspiration by you, by the masters. As you see here in Athens, 1896, we had in the first Olympic Games, we had also the first presence of fencing in Olympic Games. In this final of foil was between one French and one Greek. Finally, the Greek won, and the Athenians took this Greek fencer, which then his name was Leonidas Pyrgos, in his their arms, and they made a round of all Athens. We see in the right the final of the Olympic in Rio 2016 against Masialas and also the Italian. We have the sport of fencing today is an Olympic and a Paralympic sport. This is a unique, you know, this is wonderful. Fencing is governed by regulation issued by the FIE, Federation Internationale de Scrim. And wheelchair fencing is governed by regulations of the IWAS, International and Amputee Sport. Now I will speak to you about the Paralympic spirit and the Paralympic sports history, which is very, very important to know the roots of the Paralympic sports. One man, very exceptional, very unique, the Sir Ludwig Goodman. In 1939, he resumes and escapes from Nazi and settles in England. Head of the Stoke Mandeville Hospital, the National Rehabilitation Center for Spinal Cord Injuries, in patients who were mostly World War soldiers. Until that day, the life expectancy of spinal cord injuries was only 2 years. Basic philosophy of sport as means of restoring health. This was his philosophy. His favorite sport was fencing. He was a fencer. Down there, you will find a reference and you can open it when we will give you the whole presentation to use it as you want and promote the sport. I will show you now the philosophy of Paralympic Games. And you can see it also by your own in YouTube.
In 1944, a Jewish doctor who was a refugee from Nazi Germany started a new spinal injuries unit at Stoke Mandeville Hospital. At the time, patients were only expected to live for 2 years, so the idea was to make their remaining days as comfortable as possible. Ludwig Gutmann had other ideas about their life expectancy and insisted on managing treatment his way. His approach was controversial to many, but Gutmann single-handedly revolutionized the care of the paralyzed. He got patients off sedation and turned in bed every 2 hours to prevent infections. Next, he insisted they got up and moved around by taking part in craft and sporting activities. One of Gutmann's most inspired ideas was to get wheelchair patients playing competitive sport as a way of improving fitness, boosting self-esteem, and restoring personal dignity.
He changed my way out of all recognition because it gave me so much more confidence. You know, I knew that I was only equal to anybody. I don't know where I would have been without him.
On the same day as the opening of the 1948 London Olympic Games, Dr. Gutmann organized a team from the Star and Garter Home to compete in an archery demonstration, and it had a lasting impact. The 14 men and 2 women who took part that day became the first Paralympians. Gutmann organized a similar event every year, and in each successive year, the games got bigger and better. In 1952, the first international event was held when a small team from the Netherlands came to compete. From this date, Popper, as he was endearingly known, refer to the games as the Olympics of the disabled.
How important are games like these to paraplegics?
Very important from both the physical and psychological point of view, but the most important is from the point of the social reintegration of the paralyzed into society.
The 1960s.
This was the most important awards in the history of Paralympic sports.
Held overseas for the first time, just after the Olympics in Rome.
400 paralyzed men and women took part, representing 24 countries.
From this point on, an annual event was held at Stoke Mandeville, and in each Olympic year, the games moved, in the hope that they would be held in the Olympic city.
My first ever Paralympic Games was Tokyo, and I was lucky enough to come back with 2 gold medals, including the first ever track event.
The Paralympic movement continued to grow.
Popper Goodman would have loved to have been here now.
He had an extraordinary idea. And from that small acorn in Stoke Mandeville, we're now going to have 4,200 athletes from 165 nations competing in the London 2012 Paralympic Games. That's an awesome journey in just 64 years.
What amazing story. All we have to know this, and inspired by Sir Ludwig Goodman, which first discovered that it was very important for paraplegic. Now you will see something I found. A French coach gave it to me, Gerard Six. So we have some information that in 1780, in 1895, in the 19th century, for example, 1780, a book by the French Dr. Tissot, La Gymnastique Médicale Chirurgicale, fencing exercises are recommended after studies and cure many kinds of afflictions. 1895, Dr. Celestin Lecon defended his thesis on fencing from a medical point of view and described 15 cases of cured illnesses or remissions thanks to fencing. And 19th century, the Swedish Link developed a method of physical education inspired by the fencing courses he took for his rehabilitation system. So remember, fencing is a medicine. Here, you will see a very important time machine for wheelchair fencing. In 1973 was the first presentation in Stoke Mandelfield for the wheelchair fencing. In 1960, we had the first Olympic Games, the first Paralympic Games in Rome. In 1972, it's very important because in these Paralympic Games, we have fencing in all categories. In Bremen, in 1981, was the first European Championship. In Belgium, Mal, in 1986, we had the first World Championships. In Oviedo, in 1998, we had the first World Cup. And in Torino, in 2006, we had the first combined World Championships with able body fencers. So FIA and IWASF was together. Here, we can say that wheelchair fencing has a long, long history. A sport with a long tradition and history was first introduced at the Stoke Mandelville Games by Sir Ludwig Goodman in 1954 as a World War rehabilitation and recreation in hospital for spinal cord injuries. And it is a Paralympic sport from the first Paralympic Games in Rome 1960, as it was in 1896 for as an Olympic sport in Athens. Now, the wheelchair fencing, it is a rehabilitation sport and motivates life and regeneration. Almost all the forms of disability can deal with fencing. Now, there is also a movement to integrate fencing for people with limited vision. We have competitions in national championships, regional continent, European, Pan-American, Asian Games. We have World Cups, we have satellite games, we have World Championships, and also the major event, the Paralympic Games. This broad description of wheelchair fencing is the adaptation of the Olympic sport of fencing for athletes with some form of lower extremity disability. Follows the IWAS fencing regulations. We have here also the same weapons, foil, a pair, and saber. We have individual events and team events. The competition system is the same, pools and direct elimination. We have three categories. About the classification is for the impairments, is A, B, and C category. I will introduce now Manos Bogdos, who is a Paralympian fencer, my athlete. He competed in Athens 2004, in Beijing 2008, in London 2012, and he was the World Cup ranking winner 2009. His current status now is neurologist, and he's an IWAS fencing classifier, and also he is the chairperson of Fencing Rule Commission of IWAS. Manos.
Hello from me. My name is Manos Bogdos. I thank IWAS and my former coach, Dimitris Kazaglis, for this opportunity to speak before you about classification. As Dimitris said, I used to be a Paralympic fencer representing Greece for 11 consecutive years. And right now my profession is being a physician practicing in the field of neurology. But the main reason that you will endure my presence for the next 15 minutes is because of my status as a national wheelchair fencing classifier. What is the goal of classification in Paralympic sports in general? I will give you my own personal, very simplistic idea first. The challenge is to balance competitiveness and fairness. We don't want all disabilities to compete against each other because it is not fair having minor impairments against more restrictive disabilities, mobility-wise. But at the same time, we cannot create thousands of categories having only a few people with the exact diagnosis isolated in each category because we lose on competitiveness. That is, in my view, very briefly, the main idea behind classification of Paralympic sport. Now, what's going on in wheelchair fencing? Let's first address the obvious. The structure of a procedure is based on its objective. What are the two main objectives in wheelchair fencing classification? First of all, to assess eligibility. Eligibility addresses the question, who can enter the wheelchair fencing world as an athlete? And secondly, to group the fencers into sports classes. A sport class aims to ensure that the impact of impairment is minimized. In other words, that simply means that a sport class groups athletes with similar restrictions with regard to the sport. All eligible athletes are allocated to a specific sport class. So for number one, we need the completed medical diagnostic form signed by a certified physician with all the supporting medical documents that describe the impairment. Also, we will perform specific measurements depending on the type of disability to conclude whether the athlete reaches the desired cutoff of that particular impairment. That cutoff for every impairment is called minimum impairment criteria. It must be understood that the classification process begins by the time the EMDF and medical documents are filled. It is a very important process that showcases the medical diagnosis that renders the athlete as a wheelchair fencer candidate. If this first step is ignored or done suboptimally, then the classification assessment cannot take place. For number two, to allocate a sport class, we need, again, the medical documents, and we do more extensive tests concerning not only the lower limbs, but also the trunk, as well as the fencing arm. And at the end, we might observe the fencer during competition or training to validate the goal of the assessment. Επόμενη διαφάνεια, δεν είναι. Okay, in this slide, we will talk briefly about the concept of eligibility. But before that, I would like to give you your starting point, and I'm referring to you, new coaches. So, from the standpoint of a fencing instructor, his or her interest should be guided by one question. Can this new fencer who I have before me compete standing? Meaning non-disabled fencing, of course. If the answer is probably not, then bring him in or her in for classification. That is your starting point. Can the person fence competitively in a standing position? always remember that wheelchair fencing requires a certain degree of disability in the lower limbs, emphasis on certain degree, because not all lower limb impairments will grant you access to the sport. And one thing to note, if the disability is absolutely restricted in the upper limbs, then the athlete is outright rendered non-eligible for the sport. In the picture on the left of the slide, you can see the clinical signs and symptoms that renders a fencer eligible for wheelchair fencing. Now, I don't want you to get overwhelmed with all those fancy medical terms. For me, the most important thing is to ask yourselves that questions we talked before and advise the fencer to collect medical documents that explain his or her clinical status in order to submit them, of course, to IWAS before any given competition. Now, who is eligible for the sport? An athlete needs to have an eligible impairment listed on the left, which is permanent and complies with the minimum impairment criteria. The minimum impairment criteria is the predetermined cutoff we discussed in the previous slide. All three requirements must be met, and in any other case, the athlete is rendered non-eligible for the sport. Επόμενη διαφάνεια. In wheelchair fencing, we have three categories, as Dimitris said, A, B, and C, with the minimum disabilities lying in category A and the more restrictive mobility-wise in category C. Category A includes sport class 3 and sport class 4. The disabilities here affecting only one or two lower limbs, and the fencers, they have perfect or near perfect trunk control. With prime case example, the lower limbs amputees, and also low level spinal cord injuries, causing usually what we call a flaccid type of paraplegia. Category B includes just sport class 2. Here, athletes, they have suboptimal trunk control, but they have good, perfect hand function. Impairment example in this category, we have usually mid-thoracic spinal cord injuries, causing by definition a spastic type of paraplegia. Category C includes sport class 1A and class 1B. The main difference between these two is elbow extension. Okay, in sport class 1A, we don't have sufficient muscle strength in the extensions of the elbow, but in class 1B, there is sufficient muscle strength in that particular muscle group. Both of these classes will need to strap the weapon in their hand, and they also have weak trunk control. The disability archetype for this category is a cervical level of spinal cord injury causing what we call quadriplegia. We use specific standardized tests to assess trunk function, lower and upper limbs. In the picture on the right, you can see some functional tests, some of them, that we use to assess trunk control. And always remember that the trunk is crucial to allocate the sport class. Next slide, Dimitris. Here we have some terms that it's always good to be familiar with. Classification panel are those charged with the assessment, of course. Usually it is a team of two, except in exceptional circumstances where can be only one. Remember the distinction between a sport class and a sport category. A sport class groups athletes. A category groups sport classes. Competitions are organized on the latter. Apart from sport class allocation, the classification panel must decide the status of the sport class. The term sport class status explains if the fencer needs to be reevaluated sometime in the future. We have four different results on that. We have sport class status new, which is the status usually coined in national level assessments. Status confirmed, when disability is stable and the athlete will not need to be reevaluated. Status review when reevaluation needs to take place, and status review fixed date when reevaluation needs to take place, not before a certain date. Επόμενη διαφάνεια. Okay, next, thank you. This is the most important slide. This is the summary, the take home message. First and foremost, everything begins from the question in the training room. Okay, can the athlete compete standing? Secondly, advise the athlete to pay attention in the documents. They have to be adequate, explanatory, and in English. The athlete should bring his or her competition wheelchair in the assessment room. Only one person should accompany the athlete in the assessment room. No more. Remember that eligibility is decided by the status of the lower limbs and sport class allocation by arm, trunk, and lower limbs. Very important. If the athlete will use adaptive or assistive equipment like a thigh or knee strap, he or she needs to declare that in the classification panel. If he or she desires to change or add any other adaptations, sometime in the future, the athlete needs to apply for re-evaluation. Number nine, always advise the athlete to avoid misrepresentation during assessment. It's never in the athlete's favor to misrepresent his or her status in the room. The process is very standardized and you cannot mask your abilities. And even the most remote chance that you do, remember that what is being decided in the room will be validated on the pist. So never forget that a fair classification procedure equals to a fair game. That's all for me. I hope I did not miss any important points that I have not raised to you. Thank you very much for listening. I will pass now the torch again to Dimitris.
Thank you very much, Manos.
Thank you.
So, according to the information gave us Manos, we have the categories in weapons. We have foil and a pair in categories A, B, C classification. We have saber in women's and men's in A, B. Also, we have teams in women and men. The teams mixed are mixed classification categories. One team must include at least one B or one C classified fencer. We have also age categories, under 17, under 23 years old, and senior category. Now, we have foil. You know, in wheelchair fencing, we have foil also as FIA, the same point weapon. It is conventional also, the right of way. The weight of the point is 500 grams. The weapon is the same regulation, you know, from FIA. It's very technical, very accurate, and the valid target is the same, the electric vest, and develops speed, reaction, and coordination. I will show you now. I have two videos. Okay, I will show you woman first. I had the final game between legend of the sport of you and also one excellent Zhang. I will show you some minutes of this because tomorrow we will show more videos in referees. I will show you from 9:10, the Chinese is in front of the score, 11-9.
Very much. This course of momentum.
With your experience, you can see how speed sport is, foil, how accurate. What amazing hit by Chinese. The fencing phrase is the same, okay? As you know in FIA rules. Wow, 13. Invalable.
Just over a minute left. In the first of the three rounds. Pulls back within one. Celebrating. Points. 12-11 to Jiang. And as I mentioned, the final on Monday.
Tomorrow we will explain all the rules of the wheelchair fencing you might have to know. I just want to show you a taste, to have you a taste about wheelchair fencing and how dramatic sport is in a high level.
Shortly. So,
what a great comeback of you.
In front for the first time in this match. She's two away from retaining her gold medal. You just checking. Everything's in order. It is. She remains 2 points for gold.
13-0.
But so is Jack. And this is the exact same moment. It was tied, but this time it's you, who is 1 point from the gold medal. Unbearably tense here in the fencing hall.
So the winner of the Olympic Games in Paralympic Games in Beijing was you, a legend of the sport. I will show you a very little to see the difference about the final of this men's foil. It's between Chinese, yeah. And the Oswald from Hungary in Rio Paralympic Games. The last minutes of the final.
Yeah, like you said, though. Yeah, very, very confident in his own assessment.
Back on guard. Where were you? Just one point away.
She win with gave it away with time.
With too quick a reaction.
So, we pass to the other weapon we all know. It's Xiphos Monomachias in Greek, if you want to know. Epe or Degen. Okay, it's for men and women, A, B, C categories. It's a point weapon also. Weight of the point the same, 1750 grams. Weapon regulation is the same of the FIE. The legs are covered by metal skirt for target isolation, the apron. This is the main difference with the FIA sport. So the legs are not in the valid target. Develop speed, tactic, coordination, and patience. The valid surface is trunk, hands, and the mask. I choose some videos again. It is the video from Rio Paralympic Games also. I will show you some hits of the
this referee is not gonna let anything
the game
past her.
The amazing team of Noble of France with Noble Robert Sertel. And the other side,
coming into
also the
equalizing 24
the Chinese,
but 2-1 up,
Qian
Hansun,
and San.
Paralympic champion.
Well, now look
how fast it is.
Move. There's so much movement in those.
You see Robert Sittel, one historical fencer. He competed in many Paralympic Games. And he's exactly the spirit of the sport with fun and create happenings inside the competition.
Again. Well, there's a different edge to this Chinese team in this match, that's for sure.
So we are in the last match with Noble and Tian.
As though already
it was a very dramatic game.
2-point difference between these teams, and France throughout this match have lost 2 points to red cards.
Yeah, and absolutely crucial points.
Well, more than 2 points because they have points taken up. Could start to slip away for France now. Is desperation, but Noble has got a yellow card.
41-39, and
but he can't afford to sit
and need seconds.
Tian is just going to defend this point. Noble can only attack. What is going to happen? This really has been so close right the way through, but we didn't expect it to come down to the final 8 seconds. 1 point to bring it to a draw. What
5 seconds
is going to happen here? It's a last.
Oh, he's got it!
Oh, Egalite, 41-41.
So 41 each. Now then, what's going to happen here?
Oh my goodness.
Amazing.
This is ecstatic stuff here. Wow, nail biting doesn't describe it. The referee there just started the clock. 2 seconds off, maybe that was intentional, not quite sure, but 2 seconds left, and it's a draw. Well, now we are going to go to extra time.
So France was the gold medalist in EPE, a great school. Now, I will say, show you some minutes of women's EPE.
That was quite an error by the Hungarian. And she gets her first.
Just point to see how high is the level.
I'll just explain how it changes now. Zau,
the great Hungarian school in EPE.
One double would make it 5-2. And it's a single. Oh, great.
So we can pass.
Silver medal.
In saber. You can see here we have a saber in A, B category for men and women. We don't have C category classification because it is a little difficult to adapt the weapon and the sport to quadriplegia athletes. And maybe in the future, who knows? We have this weapon is a weapon of point and cut. This is conventional weapon. We have the right of way here. And the target is waist up, as you see. Right, it is the fastest weapon, and because it's very fast, we have high degree of predictability. I choose first. I will show you the women's. It is from the World Championships. Sorry. Okay. You can see the fencers. You can see also here the preparation of the wheelchair fencers and the referees and the volunteers also. How they strap the wheelchair in the piste. It is a team event here in women's saber in World Championship in Korea. And now it is a game with B category. Now you see the measure of the distance. This is important to see how the two judges see if the athletes are in the right position in the wheelchair. It is also a game of a team event between Georgia and Italy. Poland, sorry. You see the judge, he raised his hand because she saw the one of the fencers to stand up again. The first warning is a yellow card and the second a red card hit. This was a very nice hit. My para position. Yeah. an excellent remise. You can see that the fencing phrase again is the same. Very fast. The right of way exists. Attack from left. An excellent remise from Polis. So we have a victory from Polish girl. I will show you now my favorite video. I like this match very, very. This is the saber final in London Paralympics between two very, very fast fencers, excellent fencers. I will put it. So we can see the stadium is full. Spectators. So I will start from here. You can find this match in YouTube. It's between, it's the final in Sabre of London. 2012 Paralympic Games. You can see Manos here left. He's in there. And it is very, very fast. No, the riposte. It's carried and it is good. So Chen Yi Jun. You know, I like very, very much this game because I can see clearly all the phases and the fencing phrase. Have many things, and when one of my athletes start to fence, Vasilis Dounis, who was also in the Rio Paralympic Games, I told him, look how they fence, look how they fast they are. If you want to be good, you must be like them. And the miracle was that Dounis disqualified the winner of this match, the gold champion of London Paralympics. Green is required, he's left an attack. No, it's Harry. Gone to review, no. Use it just yet, ladies and gentlemen, because we are at the position. So a video review. We have also videos here. We will analyze tomorrow also in the rules. Two videos in knockout. If they win, they win the video. They can have more.
Big fight on 11-14.
Pian is very tall guy, he's about 2 meters.
Looks like he is. This is a counter
report.
Wow. Counter report.
Counter report and winner of the Paralympic Games in London. What a game. So, now I will introduce you to a beautiful Greek wheelchair fencer, my athlete. He's a Kelly Loufaki. It's very important for me because she's the first woman who competed from Greece in the Paralympic Games. It's equity is very important and historical. And she's the member of the Greek national team. And she won a bronze medal in the Montreal World Cup in 2017. And her weapon are saber. He competed in saber and a pen. I will show you a small video first. You can see that Kelly, I put this video and not from her competition because I want to show the importance of the role of the fencers for developing the sport. She is always going for represent our team and present the sport and the Paralympic sports to many people. So this is the important thing that you have to see here. So I will give the speech to Miss Kelly Loufaki. Kelly.
Hello from Greece. Hello to everyone. My name is Kelly Loufaki. I am 30 years old. I am a bank employee and a wheelchair fencer in category B. So what about my story? I had a car accident in 2012, and since then I've been in a wheelchair. My first contact with fencing was 6 years ago when my physiotherapist encouraged me to start the sport. So I decided to do fencing without having any previous experience in sports. Fencing really changed my life. Sports helps not only in rehabilitation, but also in psychology. It is very important to exceed your limits and set new goals every time. For the 6 years I've been involved with fencing, I have enjoyed the daily trip. And what I mean about this, I mean the training, the competitions, it's the journey, not only the destination. I participated in the Paralympics in Rio and was the first Greek woman wheelchair fencer at the games also. I have participated in the World Championships, in European Championships, And I have lived incredible, beautiful moments full of intensity, passion, and I'm grateful for what I can do. I have traveled all over the world and I made many friends from many countries. At the moment, me and my teammates and I are training to qualify for Tokyo. I really want to live the experience of Paralympics again and fight for the best possible result. To be honest, our coach, Mr. Dimitris, has played a very important role in all this. For me, he is not just a coach. He's not just a coach who has a lot of experience, but a friend, a supporter who inspires us. He's always by our side. And above all, we are a family. It is very important through the effort you make to encourage people to get involved in fencing or generally in sports. That's why we often visit schools with our coach where we speak and demonstrate wheelchair fencing. We show children how important it is to be involved in sports and also that you can do many things even if you are a person with a disability. Life is not only successes, but also failures. They make you stronger, and no matter how many times you fall, you should never give up. Thanks a lot for your time. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kelly. Thank you very much. I want to speak now about the benefits of sports and wheelchair fencing. A sport magically changes a person for the better in all areas of his life, make him endure, be strong in every obstacle, be fast, flexible, and dexterous. Exercise has a positive effect in our daily lives, at home, at work, at school, and while driving. All the basic functions of our body are improved. Our heart works better on the calm, but also in the intensity of the day. Our breathing becomes deeper and we feel oxygen flooding our lungs. Our brain fills with oxygen and sends back with its nerves, its joy and message to all the organs and all the systems. Our muscle gets stronger. The bones become thicker and stronger and our joints lubricated so that they do not rub against each other. Basic metabolism increases and our body weight decreases. Our sleep improves. The psychological state is changing. We see the positive and not the negative. We achieve goals and we transmit this to those around us, our family, our fellow human beings, society. I want to keep that. The amazing machine called human needs sport to regulate all its functions and increase its defense against any difficult situation. Now, you can see here a picture I found very old, maybe the oldest, with the wheelchair fencing, three girls, maybe in the first Paralympic Games or in the first presentation in England. And down, my athletes, Kelly, Effie, and Adamadia, with its smiles. So, the benefits of wheelchair fencing for me, it's neurological, psychological level, strengthening and development of physical qualities, self-control, self-confidence, general balance, happiness, improve health, reduce stress, improves the quality of life, goal achievement, and creating social relationships. Now, to find out, to take some opinions, I did that, I used a tool in the internet, which makes polls and questions. And I put this in my Facebook page and I asked the athletes, what means to you wheelchair fencing? So I receive a feedback from them and I keep this because I like very much. Means everything to me, a sport life, a family and lifestyle. Very important for our lives. Physical and mental health. I'm having a wonderful time practicing wheelchair fencing, training and meeting wonderful people and athletes. As an athlete, wheelchair fencing helped me to get focused in any situation. And this unique sport provides me the greatest chance to stay healthy and sportive, to go after my dreams and meet wonderful athletes and people, to enjoy my life at its best. Now, we finish today the presentation. Now is the time for questions and answers. You will participate. For this reason, we have a tool. Just a moment. Now, you will see Slido. Okay, I want something from you. We will participate all through the seminar. We will do it more interactive. You will go in your computer or your phone, and you will find the page slido.com. Then you will put the code, the month, 7275. There, all this time, from now to the end of the seminar, Sunday, you will put your question here and we will see it all. It's anonymous, don't be afraid, okay? It's anonymous, and please participate to this this page in Slido to make the question and the seminar more interactive. So we have some hello from Austria. Hello. We have our first here. Are there certain actions that you feel exist only in power fencing, Paris, unique attacks, so on? We're collecting the questions. You can also, we see Manos. Hello from Mexico. Okay, we are collecting. You see live the questions. Manos, can fencer change classification within 1 year? Mano, what do you say about that?
Hello. If the question is you can have a second assessment within 1 year, yes, of course you can have a second assessment. And maybe the result is a different class. Yes, may happen, of course.
Thank you. In my country is beginning and we don't have classification. Can I do direct with IWAS? Can Udo or Peter answer this question?
So actually you cannot do it direct with IWAS. So you need to find out a club, and then with your national Paralympic Federation community, you can then come to a competition to IWAS, and then you can be classified.
Yeah, maybe if you allow me, Peter, to add something.
Of course.
Manos explained very well the process of classification, but you must remember that the official classification from IWAS, that's an international level, has to be done during a competition. So it's important to understand that you can have national classification if you have a national classifier, or maybe if you go to a competition in another country and they have another classifier that can give you some guidance, but that's not going to be the official classification. The official classification will come in the first competition that fencer is going to participate.
Okay. Okay. Hello from Mexico. We start with the wheelchair fencing. So could participate in a wheelchair fencing people without legs? Manos?
Yes, of course. Lower limb deficiency is an eligible impairment. So yes, the answer is yes.
Okay. What are the changes in the COVID times in the training of fencers? Greeting from Chile. Okay, we have very dramatical changes in the training of our fencers. We are still in a lockdown this period. So from October until now, we are inside. We just have some days allowed it from Ministry of Sport for only Paralympic fencers that might go to Tokyo. Yes, there are changes. So I decided to do some special programs with internet and Zoom method. So we try to cover just the feeling of the absence of the sports and to find new things, maybe forgotten from the history of training fencing. To put it inside and make it to have a contact with the sport. So we will speak in the third day, in the training day for all these methods. Kelly, you have your question. What was your first fencing practice like? B, what was your first competition like? Kelly.
So about the first practice, I was so excited about the equipment the first time. The mask, the weapons, my gloves, everything. About my first competition, I was embarrassed. It was an unforgettable experience for me, but also I have my first victory in Lonato in Italy.
I remember Kelly in her first training. I was not sure then what category she was. I thought she was maybe not B category or C category because she was very unstable and she had her accident. And I can compare now the image of Kelly is in the training that I think she helped her a lot in her physical and psychological view. What is about prosthesis inside the body? Is it possible for a fencer who had his hip replaced with an artificial hip to start with wheelchair fencing? Manos, this is a classification.
Yes. We don't really care if there is an artificial joint, if the arthrosis is artificial or is natural. The main thing when it comes to arthrosis in classification is that if after the replacement, because of it or for any other reason, the arthrosis has a reduced passive range of movement. So if the normal range of movement of the joint is like, 90 degrees and then for some reason you have a reduced range of movement, that is an eligible impairment. In any other case, even if it's artificial the arthrosis, if you have a normal range of movement, then by itself, that's not eligible for the sport. You need to have some effect in the range of movement of the arthrosis to become eligible.
Okay, there is a question about the wheelchairs. Tomorrow we will show the wheelchairs. Exactly, all the rules about the wheelchairs, if there are specific, or how to get one. This is a question for tomorrow, so I will leave it for tomorrow. Thank you, Marcello Lorca, for your nice words. I saw another one inside here.
Dimitris or Manos, maybe.
Yes.
There was one question that was made in the chat. I tried to copy it here, but it seemed that it was too big.
Okay.
Maybe it's a little bit related with what Manos just asked, but I'm going to read it. It says, what if a person has an injury that could potentially be corrected by surgery? Does this constitute a permanent impairment in terms of being eligible for competitive wheelchair fencing?
Okay. Is that the question? Okay. So, if the impairment is corrected, that's by definition is not permanent, okay? So if after the surgery, you have zero residual impairment, you cannot compete in wheelchair fencing. Okay, you have
my question. Sorry, can I just explain that, because it's my question. If the person were considered, so total hip replacement is usually very successful, but if the person is considered too ill to have the surgery and they cannot therefore have, I think the question has been answered through the other answer. If the injury cannot be corrected, it could be corrected by surgery, but it cannot because the person is considered too ill to have the surgery. It's then more a permanent impairment. And I think you've therefore explained it in your answers earlier that if there's an impingement in the range of motion, for example, that they would be eligible.
Yes. Yes. So when it comes to arthrosis, again, as I said, it's just a matter of range of movement. That's what we, you know, take into consideration. Okay.
I want a translation here because, you know, my English is not perfect about what were the harshest prejudices you encounter with FI fencers who encountered WC fencer for the first time. So what means that? Can you explain me?
The harshest means the hardest one. Prejudices means like you have some bad thoughts, let's say, or prejudices.
Okay. I must to say that for me as a coach first. The most difficult thing as a coach was to find out in the beginning how we manage the wheelchairs, the frames, and this difference about the sports. I didn't find any difficulties about the fencing or the coaching. Or the fencing phrase, to understand the referee. The only thing was just to organize my work in the wheelchairs and in the frames. FIE and also the wheelchair fencing spirit, I found it was. In the wheelchair fencing, much better, the spirit. Everybody were friends and family, each other. They helped me, the other coaches helped me a lot to my work. And I learned a lot of things by them. And, you know, I can say something here. In Olympic fencing, in Olympic games, we lost something. And I lost something. And in Paralympic sport, wheelchair fencing, I found it. I found another spirit, and also I found a new techniques because as I will tell you in the third day, I had to work clear in fencing, not in footwork. We don't have footwork much. We have movements forward and backward, which is differs our the wheelchair fencing, and it is so fast. That made me, because I still I am a coach in fencing also, made me much better in technique and in the move and the training of an individual lesson because I rediscover many things that I had forgot for years.
May I ask? May I add some comment about that? I also was experienced that able-bodied fencers were not so accepting wheelchair fencers. But every time I'm doing that comparison, when the able-bodied fencers are making the things a little bit more difficult, but anyhow, with some competitions where we can add wheelchair fencers and able-bodied fencers together, they will then accept. So this is also our target somehow.
So, do we have any other questions? No.
I think there is one there. When starting wheelchair fencing, should you make contact with IWAS or the Paralympic NOC?
When starting wheelchair, should you?
Well, if you allow me, I can answer that one.
Yes.
I think that the answer very simple is when starting wheelchair fencing, you need to make contact with IWAS. No, not really. The idea with this seminar and the sharing of the knowledge and great spirit that Dimitris has and Peter is to motivate everybody to start in their clubs, start in their communities. But I think it's interesting if you also can visit IWAS website. I will put the IWAS email in the chat. I know that Dimitris also have it for the last day. You can make questions, you can contact people with a lot of experience. That's also very, very helpful. On a second part, if you want to have your federation member of IWAS, that's a completely different process. Doesn't mean that you have to be it to be able to practice wheelchair fencing, but if you want to compete in the future, that's another story. And in that case, I will put again the email. You can write there. We can answer all the questions in that aspect. I think it's not that important right now. But hopefully the idea is that everybody start practicing wheelchair fencing.
So I want in this time now, in this moment, I will ask to a friend if it's possible to tell us some things. I respect him very, very much as a coach. He's one of the first coaches I ever met in Paralympic fencing, my first competition. He created a lot of sculptures, a lot of fencers that won medals, but also was a prototype of this family spirit in wheelchair fencing. I want to ask Fabio Giovannini, who is here today, to speak a little to us.
Hi, hello. Hello, everybody. I, first of all, very, very compliments and congratulations for this new way to work. I think that your work, Dimitri, and of course not just your work, but also shared with Peter and IWAS, it's very, very, very important because as you say, as you know, I am a maestro, a fencing teacher, even in Olympic games. So it was for me at the beginning when I start, I start in 1986 So I was in a stock mandy two times, but and I was falling in love to, quickly, because even in that period, it was really clear that Paralympics sport and Paralympic fencing was different, a different way. I remember that in the evening in Strongmanville, we shared a beer and a magical moment all together. It was really different, but before it was really two words completely shared. I mean that Olympics fencing was totally different from Paralympic fencing, because it was not so clear that Paralympic sport, and in this case fencing sport, it's a sport. Before, it was like something that was important, nice for rehabilitation, but not all the fencer and fencer coach understood that this fencing, it is very important even to grow in the technical movement. So when I start to share in my club Paralympic, I start to introduce Paralympic fencing with the able people. The only people that understood quickly that it was very important and nice to fencing, to fence together, not just for the for something that it's a special feeling that it's important too, but that to sitting in a wheelchair and start to fencing was is a very important training, even a very important training for the Olympic athletes too. In that time was the children understood everything and start to ask me, please, can we training together? Because they understood that it was not so easy to touch, and they understood quickly that fencing, Paralympic fencing, is a sport. Now, a lot of time is passed, and I don't want to bore you with all the story, but just one date was important. I think that in 1988 in Seoul Paralympic was the first Paralympic Games that was in the same stadium, in the same village of the Olympic Games. And it was the first Olympic Paralympic Games that was with the new classification, that now it's Dimitri and as Dimitri showed to us, that classification was important because it was a functional classification that opened the fencing movement even to amputee and other handicaps. Before, it was just for Paralympic. And this a road that was a cultural road and a sporting road, and a sportive road, a technical road, because all the technical growth, the technical how can I explain the develop of technical, it always shared with development of culture. I mean, all the people start to understand that in in the club, it is important to, and it is nice, and it is to share fencing, standing and sitting. And then all the Paralympic athletes start to have more motivation to go out of the house to show themselves. And it was not so strange like before to see a Paralympic athletes make sport. So that moment, it was developed more, and now, as all you know, it's a really technical sport. The Olympic sport and the Paralympic sport are really in the same level, and it's for the young, it's quite normal to enter in a club, start to practice, but it was not so easy before. But to stop, because I don't want to talk too much, but the quality, the characteristic of Paralympic spirit, it was always keep. And I think that in the Olympic fencing, or in the Olympic sport, that of course we love and we make all the days, it is not the same speed. Because I can say, now I have 61 years, it's 35 years that I am in I was in the national Italian team before, and now we will see what happened. But really, I really can say that I learned much more than I teach. With these people, I learned to be strong. I learned that it is not so important sometimes if some accident happen or something is not so good, because they learn, they teach to me to understand that we can have a lot of opportunities to go on. And I learned a lot of things, even in the sport, in the normal sport, as a teacher. All of you know what I mean. That's when we.
This is amazing, Fabio. Really, really amazing. Thank you very much.
You know, Peter. I every day I learn. I teach to the child, and I learn to the child to see. I learn to the child too. Sometimes the French words going inside, but I really grow. I think with Paralympic athletes, because they really, really, really teach to me to be strong. When I had a difficult moment in my life, I really was stronger, and I really have to teach to this moment that it's now inside me. And
this all the things, practicing with the wheelchair, practicing with disabled people makes us stronger. This is really amazing. You know, thank you, Fabio.
Fabio is one of the first trainers, coaches I ever met in wheelchair fencing. It is very important to me to be here today, and I want to also to give a speech to my friend from United States, a coach from the national team, also enter here at five minutes just to say hello.
Hello, everyone. Mickey from USA. It's great to have all the coaches and everyone. I see former fencers and some maybe future coaches to see. And thanks, Dimitris and IWAS, on this great opportunity for everyone to know our sport even better and to maybe hear something which we never heard. So. Thank you for inviting us and making this happen.
Thank you very much, Mickey.
Thank you so much.
Peter.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Dimitri. It was really amazing. I think we can have a little forecast for tomorrow. And then the time is already going forward. And then I'd like to have a little saying goodbye from Alberto, please.
So for the second day, for tomorrow, we have in our program some history of the Paralympic Games, the referees and the rules, and also the some equipment we need and some basic information for equipment. And also in the last part, we have questions and answers again. You can send also today from this slide the address I gave you, okay? Thank you very much that you came all and you listened to us. And, I'm very, very happy for that. Alberto.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dimitris. Thank you very much, everybody, for being with us today.
Same time like tomorrow?
Yeah, tomorrow is going to be 1 hour earlier. Just
1 hour early, okay.
Yeah, everybody take account of that. Also, just remind to everybody that the link for tomorrow is different than the link from today. So just keep that in mind that every day is a different link. And just tell you everything is being recorded. Our idea is that once we finish these two sessions of seminars, we are going to post this to be available for everybody if you want to review it in IWAS website and the IWAS YouTube channel. So, once again, thank you very much, everybody, and have a good evening or day, or depending which part of the world you are.
Bye-bye.
See you tomorrow.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you very much, dear friend.
See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.